have five stellar students, I must say, who are coming to present you their life story and their personal journey to their profession and to our institution. And so we have one speaker from each school, so hopefully you'll be very proud and cheer them on when you see your representative come up. And so we actually will start with Liz Fisher. She is a representative from the Graduate School of Biomedical Sciences. Come up, Liz.
Hi, ooh, is this on? Okay. Hi, everybody. I'm Liz Fisher, as Lakeisha just so kindly introduced. I am an eighth year graduate student in the IMGP program, which is the Integrated Biomedical Sciences program that replaced the IGMP program. So the biomedical sciences has gone through a few changes over the past few years, but I am currently in the lab of Dr. Jim Lechleiter and in the CSA department. And our lab focuses on mechanisms of repair in the brain following stroke and traumatic brain injury. My specific research focuses on how a specific cell in the brain called an astrocyte can be exploited to work better using a drug that we have developed in the lab to help repair the brain better after stroke. So, it's kind of what my project is on. If anybody wants to ask later about a little bit more in detail, we can. But just in the spirit of things, I'll get things going. So I was asked to give you a little bit of an idea of what it's like to be a graduate student. So graduate school, you start out, and the first couple of years, you're taking classes. So you really want to be done with classes by the end of your second year, maybe a little bit into your third year. But then after that, you start transitioning into your lab. So you choose your lab by doing rotations, and you do rotations in your first year. You do about three or four, depending. And so these are just little mini internships, trials in the lab. So you're checking out the lab, seeing their research, what do they do? Do you like the lab? Do you like the experiments that you're doing on a day-to-day basis? And then also the lab is kind of checking you out too. Do you fit in with the group of people? Because you have to work with these people every day. So it's kind of a mutual trial period. And then after you've done your four rotations, you kind of pick wherever you want to go, and hopefully they have money for you. Because there's another part to graduate school in that I actually get paid a small stipend to go to graduate school. I'm not paying to go to graduate school, but that money comes from my mentor's grant. So they have to have the grant money for you to join the lab. So if all of these three things align, you like the lab, they like you, they have money, then you get to go. Right? So then you start in that lab, you do your research for a little bit. At the end of your second year, you do what's called a qualifying exam. And that's really just a test to see how you can think like a scientist. Can you think like a scientist? Can you plan experiments? Can you do these sorts of things? And then you're doing some more research, and then you do your dissertation proposal, which is where you do a written and an oral presentation saying, this is what I'm going to do for my thesis. And that may change entirely, but this is the plan. So there you go. And then you do your research for X number of years until you are finished. And then you do your thesis defense, which I am doing my thesis defense in 6 weeks, if you all would like to come. I'm really excited about it. It's taken me a while to get here. But so any number of things can happen in the middle. So one of the things that happened to me, for instance, is about the end of my third year, my mentor accepted a job at the Health Science Center. So originally, I started off at a different institution, and my mentor moved. So this happens fairly frequently in science that a primary investigator, the guy who heads or woman who heads the lab, can find a new job, and then they go. And as a graduate student, you have an option to go with them or to stay at the institution that you're already at. And if you go, then you lose time because moving is hard. But if you stay, you often end up switching labs, and you're switching projects, and you're starting all over again. So it's not really the best situation for the students or the postdocs or other people in the lab. But you know, you get to try out a new place. So I got to live in Texas for a while. So I'm originally from North Carolina, by the way. So anyway, so these things can happen. Other things can happen, like, you know, picking a mentor is really important. It's a really important part of graduate school, is finding somebody that you can work with. Because, you're working with this person for 5.5 years is the average. And you really have to be able to communicate well with them. But, you know, if things happen otherwise, people end up switching labs, which is another thing that happened to me in graduate school. So that's part of the reason why I've been here for 8 years. But it's been a great journey, and I'm really excited to be almost done. But so that's grad school in a mini nutshell. But how I got here, I think, is a combination of three things: outreach, mentorship, and just a little bit of luck. So the outreach portion, when I was in fifth grade, I did this Girls in Science program where once a month we went to go have lunch with girls at my school and another school, and we would hear people talk about women, talk about what they did, what their job was. The only one I can really remember is this meteorologist, and I just thought it was just so awesome and so cool, and I wanted to be like that person. So that's kind of what planted the seed in my mind that, you know, STEM was something that I was interested in. And then I kept pursuing that. I was always pretty good at math and science in school, and just kept continuing with that. And with the mentoring, I was always had like great science teachers. I don't know, I just got really lucky with really awesome science teachers. They were always really enthusiastic. And the mentor that actually got me started on the path to graduate school was my undergraduate research mentor. So I did research as an undergraduate, and he was just this vibrant personality. He would talk, and he would just move around the classroom, and he would swing his arms, and it was just so engaging, and it was so exciting, and it was so cool. Maybe that's just me. But he got me really excited about science, and I went into his lab, and we did research, and it was just a small undergraduate campus, so it was just undergrads doing research, so I got a lot of one-on-one time with him. And he's the one that sort of encouraged me to go to graduate school and encouraged me in the fact and sense that I could do something like graduate school, because my mother is a seamstress, my father's a lumber salesman. I don't really know anything about graduate school, like when I was in undergrad. Like, that wasn't a path that I thought I was going to take. But he really encouraged me, and with his encouragement, I applied, and I started in graduate school. And that's where I think the luck part comes in, is having those positive mentors and positive role models in my life, because I know that as a woman in science, we don't always get that positive mentorship and that positive reinforcement. So, you know, at starting out in about fourth grade, girls and boys are about equal in their interest in the STEM fields. But when you reach middle school, there's a drastic drop-off in the number of women young girls that are interested in science. And this is due to societal factors or the teachers saying they can't do it or that. And I feel really lucky that I've always had amazing mentors in my life that have encouraged me to pursue something that I wanted to do. And so capping that off with like my mentor in grad school and undergrad was the best. And until I got to grad school, I had always had the most supportive mentors. And I think that's really what's pushed me through. And with that, we've started the graduate school women. We've started a new group called Wisdom, which is Women in Science Development, Outreach, and Mentorship. And that's really important to me, and that's something that I've joined and we're starting to do outreach in the community. And this is and mentoring, peer-to-peer support, so supporting my fellow graduate students, getting through those times that may be a little difficult, because we all have them. And then just as a way for me to give back when, you know, give back that all I felt that I've been given in my time. So, yeah, I think that's it.
Thank you. And if you all have any questions for any of our speakers, when they all speak at the end, we'll give you time to ask some questions if you have any. So now we're transitioning to Chelsea Hope, who represents the School of Dentistry.
Hi guys, can y'all hear me?
Yes.
Awesome. Okay, so my name is Chelsea Hope, and I'm a second year dental student. I just want to take a moment to thank Lakeisha and Charlotte. Can everyone give them a round of applause just for putting on this event? I know it takes a lot of time. And it's just so important for our school to network, and I just don't feel like we have enough opportunities to do that. So Thank you to both of you ladies for doing this. Just a little bit about myself. I went to undergrad at Texas A&M University. Woo! And thank you. And I went on after I got my undergrad degree, and I went and got a master's in biomedical sciences at the UNT Health Science Center in Fort Worth. I'm a little bit non-traditional because I applied to dental school and I didn't get accepted the first time around. So I was like, well, what am I going to do? So I just went and got a master's because that makes sense, right? So I went on and did that and then got into dental school, and now I'm here. And so just to give you a little bit of background of my story all the way up to this point. So my family is really close to me, and my eldest brother had the worst teeth. Like, I mean, I've probably seen worse teeth now that I'm in dental school, but my brother had pretty bad teeth. They're crooked and just all over the place. He never smiled. He didn't talk to people. He was so shy. Like, you're like, oh my gosh, Dylan, you're so cool. But no one gave him the time of day because he didn't think that of himself. And so he got braces at like age 12 or something like that, braces for 2 years, got them taken off. And literally just like almost overnight, his self-confidence, his self-image just completely changed. Like, he started going out for like leadership positions. He started speaking. I think that was like the first time at age 14 that I saw him ever smile, which is crazy. And he just has progressed to the man that he is today. And he just graduated from the Air Force Academy, magna cum laude, and he is now pursuing a master's in aeronautical engineering. So I'm super proud of him for that. And I honestly, like, at first sight, just like watching him go through that just because of his teeth is just, I don't know, it just was eye-opening to me, and I was like, I want to be part of that. So let's fast forward a little bit to Texas A&M. So when at my time at Texas A&M, I realized I mean, at that point, I knew I wanted to do dentistry, so I was trying to find things to do, like, internationally. And I am very passionate about missions, just serving underserved areas, whether that's here locally or internationally. So I went to Ghana, Africa for 2 weeks during my junior year, and it was just the most like life-changing event that I guess that I've had. We went for 2 weeks, set up this mobile dental clinic, and this community that we went to, they hadn't seen a dentist in like 3 years. So just imagine, like, you're not getting any resources, no kind of health care, nothing. So people came in with all kinds of crazy stuff, and there was one lady that impacted me. She came in and she had to quit her job. She couldn't feed her family. She had lost so much weight. It was actually really scary just to see how bad shape she was in. But she had this one tooth that was just causing her so much pain. And so in that moment, I set everything up to help the dentist, and we got it going. She was in tears because she was just in so much pain, and got her ready, pulled out the tooth because we couldn't do anything else for her, and she just had instant relief. She started crying even more, but it was like happy tears at that point because she didn't realize that, you know, just like, I guess all that relief was just over, and it was like the problem was gone. And she could not stop thanking us. She was like, come over to my house tonight. Like, I'll serve you food. Like, stay with me for the whole week. Like, I'll give you everything. Like, what else can I do for you? Because you've completely just, like, saved me a ton, like, pain, energy, everything. I can go back to work now. And she came back the following week, and she actually got a job. And so because of that, like, she was like, I can feed my kids now, which is just like, what? Okay, that's crazy. And so because of her and a lot of other patients that I saw, I was like, I am in the right spot. I cannot wait to do this. So fast forward a little bit more. Well, I guess to type that back in, like, I've continued doing missions. So I'm part of CMDA, which is the Christian Medical and Dental Association. And they go on local mission trips, and they also go on international mission trips. And recently, I went to the Dominican, and some of my colleagues are here with me who went on that as well. And that was just really awesome to be able to get to do that. And now that we're in dental school, we're actually practicing things that, like, we've been wanting to do our whole lives. So that's really neat. So fast forward a little bit more. During my time in college, I worked for a dentist. His name is Dr. Matthews. He's not here tonight. He's actually from Spring, Texas. He's a pediatric dentist and an orthodontist. And so he gets to work with kids, and he straightens kids' teeth. And I worked for him during my time, like, outside of college during, like, the summer and Christmas breaks. And he is a huge inspiration to why I wake up every day. Every time that I am discouraged, like, I'm just like, I kind of want to quit. Like, I think of him and I think of everything that he had to go through, and I'm just like, I can do this. Because he went to school for a really long time, but just the way that to get where he is today, obviously, but the way that he treats his patients is just something that I want to do so much. He is seeing third generation patients, like he's seeing grandkids of these families, and it's just like, oh my gosh, like he knows everyone, and he always, like, the kids come screaming into his office. And initially when I started working there, I was like, why are these kids screaming? They must be so scared. I was like, what did I sign up for? And then I realized they were just so excited to come to the dentist office to go see him. And that was just like, how is it even possible? He's just a life changer to everybody. And so, and he's known so well in our community. It's like he's a celebrity, and I'm like, he's just a dentist, like, what? So I want to be like that. That's really cool. He's really cool. And so now I'm here. I'm here in dental school, and I'll just say that second year is the hardest year, and I'm looking at certain faces, and you know who I'm talking to. It is the hardest year of the 4 years. We are transitioning into clinic next year, which I know that most of us are super excited about, because everything that we've been studying for, all those crazy nights in the library, late nights in the lab, like doing lab work, early mornings just cramming for every exam that we have, like we have typically like 1 to 4 exams in like a week, which is like, how is that possible? But you just do it, and you're like, okay, I did it, cool, yay. But so with that all being said and done, like I'm certain that once this stage is over and I get to go to clinic next year, I'm certain that I am exactly where I need to be. And I hope that all of you are in the field, that you are just like so amped to get up every single morning that it's just like, oh my gosh. Okay, sorry. but that's how I feel about dentistry. And the fact that I'm getting taught how to alleviate someone's pain or just recreate their smile because they're not confident or just anything else, you know, for whatever reason, is an incredible feeling. And so I guess I want to tell y'all a little bit about dentistry for those of you who are not in the field or don't know very much about it. So dental school is a 4-year program. So after you get your DDS, you can go out and you're a dentist. You actually start working on patients. But you can also specialize. So my mentor, like I said, he is a pediatric dentist. So that's working with kids. You can do orthodontics, which is straightening of teeth. There's periodontics, which is like working with gums, recreating your gums and stuff like that, the health of your gums. And then what else is there? There's like general practitioner residency. And that's like 1 year crammed of like the 4 years of dental school. So you're getting all these like really intense complex cases in 1 year, or maybe 2 years. It just depends on the program. There's endodontics, which is like root canals. And I know there's a couple other ones that I'm missing right now, but oh, there's dentures, which are the worst. But there's people who really like dentures, so thank goodness for those people, but that's not me. So those are just a couple of the programs that you can do. So these are people that just want to focus on one aspect of dentistry, and I applaud those people because they go on to do more schooling and training and et cetera, et cetera. So I guess that's pretty much my story, and I guess I just want to encourage everyone that's here, you know, thank you for taking time to just get to meet other people that go to this school, because you're only here for a certain amount of time, and we're all going to be working with each other in some way, shape, or form, whether you know it or not. So that's it. Thank you.
Thank you, Chelsea. And now we'll transition to Kevin Washington, who represents the School of Health Professions.
Thank you. I feel a little overdressed. Everybody's like in their t-shirts, but I kind of didn't know how formal it was, so I was like, I'll throw on a sweater vest. That's kind of, that's, you know, it makes me just a little bit, right? My name is Kevin Washington. You can see it on the board, obviously. I'm in the clinical laboratory sciences program in the School of Health Professions. I've got my crew backing me up, just in case. They got their own t-shirts on for some reason, but... So I started here, this is my first year doing this. I started in the fall, and I've come a long, long way to get to this point. Where to start? Originally, I'm from Hawaii. I'm not from here. My parents were military, but I grew up in paradise, one of the greatest places in the world, right? Except I wasn't rich, so it wasn't all that great, you know, because after a while, once you've seen one beach, you've seen them all. And, you know, every time relatives would come into town, they would be like, oh, we want to go see the Polynesian Cultural Center. Oh, we want to go to the Bellows Beach. And it's like, oh, not again. It's kind of like here now that we live here, whenever somebody comes, they want to go to the Alamo. And you're like, oh. And when you're walking around, you're looking at everybody at the Alamo, and they're looking, oh, look at David Crockett sat here. And you're thinking, yes, yes, can we move along? That's how it kind of was for us. But in Hawaii, there's a sort of a dichotomous situation going on. You have a lot of beautiful splendor and tourism. But on the other side of that, you have a lot of poverty. Most people don't realize that in a lot of areas in Hawaii, it's like a third world country. I had friends who, no kidding, their parents worked two jobs at fast food restaurants. They'd work all day at McDonald's. And then they would leave and go across the street and work a whole nother shift at Burger King. So when it comes to medicine and health for them, a lot of it was home remedies. I remember for us, we had a lot of colloquial home remedies. Aloe leaves. Whenever I was a kid, we'd scrape our knees. We'd go over to a plant, snap it off, take the sap, rub it on our wound. We were fine. Jellyfish. Anybody had experience with jellyfish here? Anybody know what to do if you get stung by jellyfish? Everybody's got their own thing. Everybody. Crab boil. Put crab boil on it. Why do you have crab boil at a beach? Don't know, but everybody was bringing it. Baking soda. You use baking soda. Some people know you pee on it. And it, no kidding. And it turns out, like, back then, we didn't know why this stuff works. But then as I got older and I started getting into sciences, and I started experimenting around and looking at things, because I love looking up facts. That's my big thing. They know. And it turns out that the reason why is because jellyfish stings are mostly polypeptides and proteins. So when you're changing, you're denaturing them by using, because urine's what, about an average 6 pH. So it's acidic, and you're denaturing those proteins. Now, most people don't know that, but we know that. And that's the basis that I think of clinical laboratory sciences. We get to know the coolest stuff because we have to know the coolest stuff. I like learning those little tidbits of information. Now, how I got here from Hawaii is a different story. When my parents decided they were done with their military career, and I was starting to get older, my parents started to think, well, what if he wants to stop being a bad kid and go to college someday? And so that was a consideration. Where would I go? Because to do anything, I could either go to the University of Hawaii, and unless you're majoring in like marine biology or surfing, your options get real limited real fast. So for me to go to college, they were gonna have to come mainland side. And so being from Texas, we have some family here, my parents decided to move back. So I came here around my senior year of high school and went to Taft, and that was a jarring, another raider in the house. Jarring experience, because I didn't know anybody. And your senior year is not exactly the time to start trying to make new friends. So I felt like I was on like a CW show when I was growing up. Like, he's the new guy, he's brooding, he's so cool. But I got here and I graduated, and then I didn't go to college right away. What I did was I decided to go live life. So I was like, Mom, Dad, I'm leaving. I'm taking my wolf dog, and I'm going out into the nature, and I'm going to learn some stuff. And so I went out, and I did a lot of different things. I was a bouncer for a while. for clubs. That was fun. It wasn't Roadhouse. It's more like, sir, I'm going to have to ask you to leave. Well, okay. All right. Have a nice night. Never had any of that really cool stuff going on. But after that, I decided, you know, I'm going to move in with some friends. We're going to do this whole thing where we have like this big communal house full of like 40 people. And then I left with a whole bunch of debt. So I decided to become a truck driver. So I went on and I did over-the-road driving. And I can honestly say I have been to all the capitals of the United States of America, even Alaska. And of course, I came from Hawaii, so I was already there. After that, I came back here and I started to work for banks because I got into IT, which back then you could go into IT without any type of degree. You know, you could, did you know anything about computers? Yes. Do you have experience with Windows? Yes. All right, welcome to the job. So I did that, and I'm actually still doing that. I'll get into that in just a moment. But once I had gotten here and I had done that for a few years, I worked for a couple of banks. I got into investigations, digital investigations. Fun stuff, but a lot of hours staring at a screen. So, but after a while, I started thinking, is this what I really want to do? Because I would look at all the people that I worked underneath, and they would come in every day, big beards, suspenders. How's it going today? And I'm like, oh, not the life for me. I don't want that. I want something different. So I started looking into what else I can do. So I went back to school. I started going back to school. And I went to A&M. And originally, I was going to major in, at the time, I think it was archaeology. Because I started skipping around to different degrees. So I would look at one thing. I'd look at another thing. I would take a class in geology. And then I would become a geologist. And after a while, they were looking at my credits and going, just pick a degree and leave. Well, along the way, I took a microbiology course. And it fascinated me. This whole little micro world of battles and wars going on. You know, whole organisms and systems fighting it out for survival. It was really cool stuff. So I started really looking into that. And I was like, you know what? I'm going to be a biologist. Now, initially, though, I didn't go with microbiology, even though that's what inspired me. I started as a field biologist. I wanted to study the Crocuta crocuta. Anybody know what that is? Yeah, Pokemon? Close enough, but my studies in that are extensive. I'm going to be giving a dissertation on that a little bit later. But, no, it's the spotted hyena. It's my favorite animal. I don't know why. I don't know where I picked this up. Where it's like I've never seen a hyena in my life up close. But somewhere along the way, I was like, that's the one. That's my spirit animal. So I started taking biology classes. And again, I came into more and more clinical applications because they make you take a range of stuff, right? They don't just say, all right, you want to be a biologist? Here's a Jeep. Here's a camera. Go out there and study. So along the way, I started thinking, well, this is fun. But then I started realizing I like teaching it too. So I started going to A&M at about 2010. And from that point on, to sort of shorten things up, I got my first degree in biology, I got a second degree in biology, and then I got a third degree in education. And I decided to do high school teaching, freshman biology. Yeah, I'm here now. Took me 1 year to realize that I want to do something else in my life. So I started looking at what else can I do. And I had a friend who actually was in the health professions. And she's like, oh, I'm doing this MLS thing. And I'm like, what's it like? And she's like, super cool. So I started looking into it because I'm thinking, that's what I want to do. Working in a lab. Imagine myself with my cow pow on one desk. And, you know, looking through microscopes. People going, what are you looking at? The world. So when I started looking into it, but then I realized you needed certifications. So I'm thinking, well, how am I going to get certified for this? Well, I'll have to go to a different school. Well, along the way, I started looking into different types of schools for certification for MLS. And I realized there's a whole health professions field out there. And so once I came across UT Health Science Center, I started looking at the MLS program here, and I realized they had a master's program. I'm like, that's it. That's what I'm going to do. I'm going to go into the master's. Now, I didn't choose any of the others. Health professions is a large field here. There's about six different disciplines, I would call them. You've got your respiratory therapist. Anybody here from respiratory therapy? Woo! You've got your occupational therapy, your PA school. Like the one PA person. You go, you. You've got your emergency services, and then you've got us, the CLS. And physical therapy? Oh, there you go. Okay. I thought I said that, but I guess not, because they're like waiting. Like, when's it coming? So the things that bring us to these points in life, because there is one thing I forgot to tell you. Along the way, when I really wanted to decide how I wanted to finish out my education, around 2011, me and my dad, my dad retired, and he started hanging around the house a lot. And then he started hanging around the house a lot. And part of that was because my dad suddenly started to come down with some sort of illness. And we didn't quite know what it was. So I would start taking him to dialysis. It happened so fast. Within 2 months, he was going to dialysis. So I would go to school, I would take him to dialysis, I would come home, I would study, and then I would go to work. When I came back one day from school, I was talking to my dad. He had just come back from the hospital. We were sitting there, and he's like, "Oh, what are you doing?" "Oh, I'm going to go sleep is what I'm going to go do." So I went upstairs, and I think I'd been asleep for about 10 minutes when my mother comes running upstairs, and she's frantic. She's like, "Please, please come downstairs. I think your father's gone." So I go running downstairs. I don't know what to do. The alarm is going off, and it was such a surreal moment, because everything seemed to happen in slow motion. I remember getting my father onto the ground and starting CPR. I remember telling my mother to turn off the house alarm and to call 911, which she couldn't do because she was so shaken at the time. So I remember having to try and dial 911 on my phone and return to doing CPR on my father. I remember when the EMTs arrived, I remember going to the hospital. And then I remember going to chemistry class to take a test, because I had a test and I wasn't going to fail it. So I went and I took the test. The instructor was shocked to see me there because he'd heard through a friend of mine that something happened to my father. I took that test and my father died the next day. Now the problem with that for us was that the whole time, it was probably about maybe 4 months that he went from being a strong, healthy individual to being gone. And for me, that impacted me. And I think that's when I really made that change from just a biologist to really wanting to do something in health professions. Because we never really found out an answer. We never really understood why. We never got told. Nobody could explain it to us. For me, I would never want to see anyone else ever go through a situation like that again. People have a fundamental right to be helped. They need people who are experts, people who have the ability, the talent, and the drive to be able to do something to help them. So I came here, and I'm still here. William Osler, who founded the Johns Hopkins Hospital, once said that medicine is a science of probability and an art of possibility. I think that's what he said. It may have been something slightly different. But the point being, it was very, very inspirational. We are really connected here in a different way, and that's why I think things like this are good for us. Because we need to see the other faces and know that it's not just the people in your class. There's a whole network of individuals out here. There's a whole network of us working together to accomplish a common goal, which is to progress mankind in the arts of health. Every one of us is kind of like, I like to think of us like dots. You know, you've got your medical school, that's a dot. You've got your doctors and your dentists. Those are more dots. You got your CLS, you got your therapists, you got your PA school. They're dots. And all these little dots are like little lights shining in the darkness. Now, a single light in a cavern, a single little candle, may not be much in the dark. But when you take a single light and you multiply it with multiple lights, you end up with, you can beat back the darkness. You start whole galaxies, right? When you think about it, galaxies are little points of light. Each one of them is a point of light. And then they combine. Every star within that galaxy combines to make more light. You got suns, you got planets, and astronomy is pretty cool, but that's a whole other topic. We together can accomplish great things. We as individuals, we can be strong. But we as united individuals, connected to one another, supporting one another, we can accomplish much more. We can stand on shoulders of giants and then be lifted even further by giants coming along behind us. We can be better. We can be candles in the dark. I will leave you with this idea. Look out here today at every person that you see. Find somebody in your class, in your school. Find somebody at one of these tables. Find this person, introduce yourself, and make them your nemesis. Having a nemesis will drive you in ways. No, I'm just kidding. But in seriousness, find someone, because together we can make things so much better for people. We can make things so much better for ourselves. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Kevin. And now I'll introduce you to Derek Wallace, who represents the School of Nursing.
So there's been a lot of tough acts to follow, and I'm up now, so dropping the ball. So nursing, we have seven kind of-ish master's programs. I don't know if they're lumped in together. Some two different master's programs can be seen as one. We have two different doctorate programs. And then we have a bachelor's degree in which I'm in my second semester. And so how the bachelor degree is set up is you do 2 years of prerequisites, and then you come here, you apply, you get accepted, and then you do 4 semesters, 2 years of nursing. And it's really interesting because I know with med school, I believe it's 2 years didactic and then to 2 years clinical, which nursing is while you're going through the lecture, you're also going through the clinical. So you immediately learn something one day and you apply it in the hospital the next. And fun fact about nursing, they also do research. I did not know that until I actually got there, and I do research with one of the teachers at the School of Nursing. The nursing program is a bachelor's degree, a four-year degree, and I'm in my second semester, so I have a year after this to go. So why nursing? When I was in high school, my freshman year, I did a lot of pole vault and water polo, and that took a lot of damage to my back. And since then, I've had 6 back surgeries, and being young and dumb, I didn't know a lot, and so I would go to doctor's appointments and they would tell me these things and the words were foreign. And so, of course, something was happening to my body and I wanted to know why it was happening. And so that's when I started kind of researching on my own what was going on. And that piqued my interest into medicine. What I was going through got me looking in that field. And so it's a broad field, and so I knew I had to pick something. And so why nursing? I picked nursing because I own a mirror. I realize that I'm not that attractive, and 81% of the students are females, so I'm trying to stack my odds. No, that was just serendipitous. That was just a pro. But the real reason I picked nursing was the hospital that I had 4 of my surgeries at was in Dallas. And fantastic staff, fantastic nurses, because, I mean, I mostly interacted with the nurses because that's who you're with most of the time. It was the little things that got me. It was, I didn't like water, and so I liked juice, and so every time that I would have to take medication, they would automatically do that. It was a very nice thing. Another thing was, during the night when they have to take vitals, of course, my mother was there on the pull-out chair, and most of the time, they wouldn't even wake her and get my vitals, and so I thought that was amazing. And of course, I had one negative experience with a nurse. And so for my third surgery, it was a more extensive surgery. I was in longer. And so I had a little bit more drugs in my system. And so because of that, I was still catheterized. But right after you're awake and you're oriented, they want you to walk. And so they got me up to walk, and I was still catheterized. So I get up, and I'm holding the IV pole. And she's holding the cath bag. And I ask her, I'm like, do you want me to hold it? And she's like, no, I got it. And so we start walking, and as we're walking down the hall, she drops the catheter back. I go down a little bit, because where the bag goes, I follow. And so she was getting mad at me because I was bending. I couldn't bend because I just had back surgery. And I was trying to explain male anatomy. That experience kind of left a bad taste in my mouth. And so when I was there, I had a lot of great nurses. And I realized that the nurses there made a bad experience better. And that negative interaction with that one nurse, it kind of made a bad experience worse. And so that's why I picked nursing, because I want to be able to impact people staying in the hospital. I want to be able to give them at one of their worst moments a little bit of a happiness in there, and so that's kind of why I chose nursing. Last semester, this was kind of nice because healthcare professionals, all of us are, and in some form or fashion, school gets kind of overbearing, and it gets very stressful. And sometimes it's very hard to see a lot of good things, and a lot of times you second guess what you're doing. And my mother, 2 years previously, had breast cancer, and last year in August, she was diagnosed that it metastasized to two places in her brain, the cerebellum and the frontal lobe. So it was downhill quick for 3 months, and the things to go was mainly her cognition and her motor movement. And so I took a partial leave to help my dad care for my mother. And when we were caring for her, I can't imagine what my dad was going through. But he would try to, as an example, he would try to, well, you know, let's get dinner in her. She has to eat. Well, it would take 10, 15 minutes to figure out what she wanted to eat because she couldn't concentrate for that long. And so I automatically stepped in the role of trying to facilitate that. I saw that frustration he had, and she developed frustration because he was getting frustrated and she was the cause of it. So I automatically filled in that role of kind of a patient caregiver. I saw that eased a lot of her tension. And I can't imagine what my dad was going through. I can't fault him. And so it was nice. It was a good reminder that we're all here for a reason. And a lot of times it seems overbearing. And it was really nice in unfortunate circumstances that it helped me solidify why I'm here. And it also kind of gave me a message that I got with my surgeries is, and it's kind of hopefully a message that I'll get across, and hopefully it's implemented in practice, is how you do something is just as important as what you're doing. You can't change what's happening to a person, but you can change their experience. Like I mentioned earlier, you can make a bad situation a little bit better. And just for when I was in the hospital and what my mother was going through, a lot of the positives were good, but a lot of the negatives were really bad, and those were the ones that, kind of left a sour taste in my mouth. And so that is honestly why I chose nursing, was I wanted to impact patients' stays, and so that is why I'm here. Thank you.
And our final student presenter for tonight is Charlotte Collins from the School of Medicine.
Okay. Hi, everyone. So, medical school. It's 4 years. I'm a second-year medical student. The first 2 years were primarily in the classroom. It's called your preclinical years. And we do get some clinical exposure. I think our student-run free clinics are pretty cool. And at the refugee clinic, we work with dental students and nursing students and pharmacy students. And we have global health trips, and you know, we get some exposure. At the end of those 2 years, we study really hard for a super big test called STEP. And that's what I'm doing right now. It can be really scary because it's kind of the first portion and most important portion of our licensing exam. And so after we take this really big test, we start our third year in July. And this is when we get our clinical exposure. So we're in the hospital now. And you rotate through all the different specialties. And so this is also the time when you figure out what kind of doctor you want to be, where you click, what you love. And so at the end of your third year, you pick a specialty. If you want to be a surgeon or a psychiatrist, a neurologist, whatever it may be. And your fourth year, you kind of get to lay back and relax a little bit. And that's when you're applying to your residency program. You're going to those interviews, and then you're kind of finishing up some graduation requirements, electives, and kind of doing little electives, specializing in what you really want to do. And so at the end of your fourth year, you match, and you match into your residency. And so residency is when you get to kind of hone in on those skills of whatever specialty you pick. So they can range anywhere from 2 years to 6 years. And then if you're really crazy after that, you can do a fellowship, and you can specialize even more. So I primarily ended up here because of my sister. She's kind of what got me even thinking about considering applying to something as crazy and as hard as something like medical school. So she's a year older than me, and she has struggled with mental illness and developmental disabilities and physical illness for her entire life. Her current diagnosis right now, or one of her diagnoses, is pervasive developmental delay. And that's one of the five disorders on the autism spectrum. So what is autism, right? Autism is a huge, broad spectrum, and you can present in so many different ways. And I think that was something that made it so hard for my family, the uncertainty of the diagnosis. So she didn't initially have this diagnosis for that very reason. She's been in and out of hospitals. We've seen numerous doctors and psychiatrists across the United States. She's been genetically tested, and she's had a whole range of diagnoses from bipolar disorder, obsessive compulsive disorder, personality disorders. But right now, this is the diagnosis that we have. I think that what was most difficult for me and my family was the fact that when you have autism, you have a really hard time communicating. They are lacking in social skills, and it's really hard for them to express themselves. And I think having a child or having a sibling that can't fully express their love or communicate how much they care about you can be really painful, right? And so she's also, I love her to death, but she's really difficult. It's really hard for us to go in public places. She's really volatile. We don't know when something sporadic is going to happen or when she's kind of going to go into a panic, right? So we suffered a lot, but you know who really suffers is my sister. And she's really taught me that, you know, there's a lot of people out there that feel like they don't have a place in society where they feel like they fit in or they belong. And so I initially decided to come to medical school because I wanted to help people who were suffering, yes, but I wanted to help people get to a place where they felt like they could feel like they were a part of something and that they could function and be a part of our society, whether that be physically or mentally. And I decided I wanted to become a psychiatrist because with working with my sister and living with my sister, I think mental illness and physical illness a lot of the time go like hand in hand. Ironically enough, right around the time I decided this was the path I was going to take, I got diagnosed with my own psychiatric diagnoses. So I got diagnosed with anxiety and depression. And like my immediate thought that came to my head was, okay, well now how am I supposed to be a doctor taking care of other people if this is my diagnosis, right? And how are other people gonna perceive me? Are people gonna take me seriously? And I was scared. So I just kind of put those diagnoses in a little box and I thought I'd just shut it and they wouldn't come back out. And for any of you who know anything about mental illness or, you know, have a friend or a family member, that box wasn't going to stay shut. It kind of really fully opened back up during my first year of medical school. I'm now in consistent counseling every week with our wonderful counseling center, and I'm medicated and I see a psychiatrist. And I think that's all really great, but I think what's even more great is that I'm open about it, right? Because I think what made me so sad for so long is that I was trying to hide a part of myself that I think is what's going to make me such a great doctor. I think that gives me so much insight into empathy and human connection and really listening to people's stories and trying not to make a judgment about someone. And so the reason that I share this with all of you here is because I kind of started coming out and talking to people, and I realized I'm not the only one that feels this way. We're all in a really demanding field, and sometimes it can get really hard. And there's a lot of people who don't seek help because they're scared of the negative consequences professionally or socially. And I think that's really sad, and I think there's a huge need to get rid of that stigma and share your story, because pursuing a career in a field that's really demanding and having a mental illness, those two things are not mutually exclusive, and to be open about it, I think is super important. And so I'm just here to say, you know, if you know of anyone who's struggling, talk to them, reach out, because it does not do any good to keep it inside. And I think really, honestly, that's what, you know, brings out empathy in people and human connection. So yes, I have anxiety and depression, but yes, I'm going to be a pretty awesome doctor. And, that's because I'm taking care of myself. So I just encourage all of you to do the same, and I applaud you for pursuing something that's really difficult and really hard. So yeah, that's my story. And before you clap, I just wanted to say that in April, there's a medical service fee referendum, and this is where you can vote to expand the services that are offered by the Student Counseling Center. And there's a huge need for this. So you can get more information at this website. Feel free to come up to me or Lakeisha if you have any questions. But You know, the Student Counseling Center here has been a gift to so many of our students, to go to a place where they feel safe and valued and heard, with free services and on our campus is awesome. So we'd love for you to get out and vote. And yeah, that's about it.